Hey folks, welcome to the Unsung Podcast, where we talk about albums that we think are underappreciated and why. I'm joined by
and why do we bother?
And just in general, why? What's even the point in anything anymore? I'm joined by, of course, my regular host, co-host Chris Cusack, and a very special guest. Welcome back, Anna Goldthorp. It's nice to have
you
again.
Thank you. It's good to be back, guys.
It's good to have another punk in the room, I'll tell you that.
Not like this. Hippy, wee's long hair.
Where's Weaver? What's he up to?
He's away being metal somewhere in a field.
Yeah, I wonder what he does in his weeks off. How do you think he uses that? Weaver claims he's been walking 20,000 steps a day.
That's really impressive.
Or stupid. But Dave's probably halfway to Sunderland right now, going at a rate like that. But Anna, it's lovely to have you here, and you know stuff about this, which is going to help.
Well, I mean, maybe a wee bit, but yeah, don't get your hopes up.
You know people that have got their hopes up, the people that contribute financially to this podcast.
Chris, I'm glad you mentioned that. I want to shout out two of our new subs. We've got Mr. Dan Morgan, thank you for joining us, and Mr. I'm sorry if I butcher this, Roshan Bahitia? Sorry, mate. I messaged you on Patreon the other day, so if I fucked your name up, you can just get back at me. Thanks for giving us your hard-earned cash.
Did we get any more contributions because I upset people this week?
Nobody has said anything about that, thankfully, so yeah. Sorry.
It seems to be our main money-making technique these days, is to get them to pay me to shut up.
Yeah.
I was going to ask, can they get a refund if they're offended by Chris?
There are no refunds.
Yeah, I'm worried they'll ask for a refund if they're not offended by me. I think it's like some kind of weird musical masochism where you listen to this just to get angry.
Well, we did get a little bit of kickback on our from the Faith No More fan sites, two Faith No More fan sites for calling Chuck Mosley a hack.
I believe the quote was, "You lost us when you called Mosley a hack."
Yeah.
Horrifying.
How can you? I don't understand, right? I've been wrestling with this like since I read that message. Like, I love a lot of bands, man, but I'm also like completely capable of seeing the flaws in their music that annoy me. How can you possibly love fucking Chuck Mosley? I don't understand it.
The thing is, as is the scientific nature of this program, that we didn't just say it and then just drop it and move on. We actually pulled apart a few songs where he sounded like fucking garbage, and then here you go, here's some evidence that this guy's a fucking hack. It's not good enough for some people. Science no longer means what it used to mean. That is the problem of today's society. Talking of which, if you are a listener and your dog is currently barking at your phone, it's probably because your dog is very intuitive and I might have COVID or not.
are dogs able to sniff out COVID? Is that what we're going to do now instead of having test centres? Just unleash the hounds into the country?
You think you're being sarcastic, but that's an actual thing. That's an actual thing. Dogs are, honestly, I'm not making this up. I invite you all to go and look it up, but there's a whole army of COVID dogs out there that are much better, much more reliable at diagnosing it than the swabs, which I had a wee encounter with today. I would have rather had an encounter with a dog. But yeah, so we don't know at this stage. I'm isolating in my house, getting food sent in, and generally feeling a wee bit under the weather. But what better things to do when you're feeling under the weather?
What I would like to say, Mark, is I think you've made an interesting choice this week, and I'm looking forward to discussing it.
Well, we should probably review what it is if you haven't already read the title of the episode. We're doing Jersey's...
It's not much of a review.
Yeah, I know. We're doing Jersey's Best Answers by Lifetime.
You must tune your guitar to ours. We will start with the first string.
Who are kind of still maybe are punk band, punk-ish emo band, I suppose. Well, as it turns out, they were actually a hugely influential emo core band. They are, of course, from New Brunswick, New Jersey, because they have a song titled about New Brunswick. They began in 1990 when singer Ari Katz met the guitarist Dan Yemin at hardcore shows in New York. the East Coast has a pretty virulent, shall we say, hardcore scene. Always has had, ever since the '80s, and still does to this day. They've released 4 albums to date, one of which is only available on compilation CD, which is probably a really good shout, actually. We'll come to that in a little bit. They were then complete by Chris Covino on bass, Dan Wagenschutz on drums, and Scott St. Hilaire, who is also the second guitar player.
That didn't happen, though, until their second album.
Well, actually, they had a whole bunch of different drummers. So the first EP, as I was going to say, the first EP was released, self-titled and released in 1991, and Addy Katz played drums on that. So I guess they must have had an even more revolving lineup than is quoted online of players coming in and out until they actually solidified their whole thing around about Hello Bastards, their second album, I'd probably say.
All the old members are hidden in the marshes around about New Jersey, Sopranos style. Oh. So they don't claim any royalties.
Fucking royalties, man, can you imagine it?
Coming out the woodwork for 20 quid.
That's one of the reasons, I suppose we'll get that, but that's one of the reasons why they stopped being a band. It's because they didn't want to be a proper band.
Mafia. One of them get into gambling debt, and basically to get out the gambling debt, they took a quarter of the band. Next thing you know, you're running all the songs past Phil Leotardo. And it's just too many cooks. Phil Leotardo, hey, don't make fun of me, I didn't write Sopranos, okay?
That's so good. That has concocted a lot of imagery for me of people running about in leotards playing emo post hardcore stuff in the sand dunes along New Jersey coast.
I would have loved to have seen this band do a cameo at the Crazy Horse around about season 4, season 5. Sorry, I'm just... is all I've got to bring to the table here. So.
I know. Mark, yeah. I'm enjoying the
listeners ever notice that whenever Chris is not engaged, he just decides to derail it, but when he's doing something that everybody else wants to do, he's like, you need to be totally engaged. It's actually quite unfair.
Imagine a thing where the thing he likes, he pays more attention to. My God. It's now a good time to mention that this band is like the MF Doom of pop punk.
Yes, actually. It's a great time to say it.
Who was it was going to pay us not to talk about that again? Because I maybe need to give them a refund now.
I'm sure they'll email us in due course. Anyway, they released their first album in 1993, which, like I said, was called Background. It very much sounds like a band who are at war with themselves. They didn't really know what kind of band they wanted to be, so they're still doing quite a lot of this kind of 80s hardcore stuff, or maybe doing a little sojourn into emo on the odd song, but the vocals just don't fit at all. Addy himself states that he wishes the album was just some weird demo tape that some guy gave to you in high school that you ended up losing and that only exists in your memory. He's just really not a fan of it.
It reminded me a wee bit of what I think was quite a seminal album of this era as well, Week by the band Seaweed. Which came out in 1992, which is like a better quality version of this.
I mean, I think one of the best quotes I had from him about it here is that basically the band couldn't agree in direction that they wanted to go in, and that's why they shed quite a lot of members around about that time. So there's probably a lot of bad feeling and bad memories around it, you know, which is maybe why he's so down on it. He said he was just listening to too much bad music at the time, and it came through in what he was writing. And Dan himself is also not a huge fan of it. He said they remastered it and put it on The Swamps of New Jersey, which is a compilation album they released in 2006. I they only did that because they wanted to make it actually sound good, because the recording isn't brilliant. But he's like, it's definitely for the purists. People, he said, people come up to shows and say to him that that first album's our best, and he's like, what the fuck are you listening to? Are you actually kidding me? But that's not really the lifetime that would go on to be one of the most influential hardcore and punk bands, and I guess emo bands at the time. So before I dive into that, there's kind of something that I really realised when I, or kind of stumbled across when I was doing the research for this episode. To me, they've always been a melodic hardcore band, essentially. And I know they've always been a bit pop punk, and I know they've always been a bit hardcore. And I said that at the end of the last episode as well. But when I was doing the research online about it, I saw a lot of people mentioning emocore, which is something I'd obviously been aware of, but I hadn't really considered them as being part of. Mm-hmm. To me, that's kind of bands like Rise of Spring and Dag Nasty, and maybe even Embrace. In fact, there's an Embrace cover on one of their records as well. So I always kind of realised, I always kind of put them into a punk category, whereas a lot of people put them in the emo category. And the more I did the research, and the more that kind of shook out. So that actually made me reframe their entire canon. And I know they were kicking around right about the time when emo started to gain a little bit more popularity in 1997. And I hadn't really placed this band in that category before. And that was really weird for me, you know. I picked this record because I'm a huge fan of Dan Yemen's work. I think that Lifetime, particularly this album, is really good. I love Kid Dynamite. I think their two albums are fantastic. And I don't like painting it as black as much, but I really enjoy him going back to his kind of old school 80s hardcore roots.
Chronologically, where do Kid Dynamite and Paint It Black come in? Are they concurrent? Are they after?
One after the other. So Lifetime broke up in 1987. The first Kid Dynamite album came out in 1988, so it must have been recorded right after Lifetime finished. And then the first Paint It Black album came out in 2002, after Kid Dynamite stopped being a band. So like this kind of big one big long line. And then somewhere in around about all that, he managed to get his PhD in clinical psychology, because he's been a psychologist for 20 years now, which is mental.
That's pretty impressive.
Which is mental.
Perfect pun.
Yeah.
That's for the dads.
Took me a wee while to get that one there.
It's because you're not a dad.
You're mad. Just getting that age.
Not that you know.
To be fair, you got Mary a chance of being a dad than Anna.
Well, you know.
No, that is really impressive. And I've been to see Paint It Black before, so I know that they were a touring band.
I personally have a lot I'd like to discuss about that period, but we should maybe sketch out the lifetime of Lifetime in a little bit more detail.
Yeah, that's what we're going to do, yeah. So the reason I brought up the thing about them being emo and emo core and related to that is because I hadn't really ever considered it, and I was actually going back to background where I kind of started to hear, well, I can hear the hardcore side of it, and then I listened to Hello Bastards, which is often considered to be just as good as Jersey's Best Dancers. It's right up there for a lot of people.
It was voted as their best on Best Ever Albums, which is a kind of fan-sourced site, you know, a poll site.
Yeah, but it does have a lot of really strong tracks in it. I mean, straight away you can see there's a huge leap musically in terms of melody from background. Everything's much more major key, you know. They're kind of making hardcore sound a bit more poppy, which nobody was really doing at that time, especially when that was back in, what, 1995?
I Yeah, so that one was 95, so it'd been 2 years since the previous album.
I think it's also got Neutral Territory on it, which is a classic emo core song, I suppose. You can hear them playing around with more emo ideas alongside the sort of general hardcore chugging of guitars. They've got more playful, picky, sparse bits as well going over the top, which is something that they hadn't really done before. It sounds pretty cool, and it's actually interesting to hear how quite far ahead of their time they were, because like Anna said, a lot of bands would then go on to rip off this sound 5, 6, 7, 8 years later. It's also got a really cool Husker Du cover on it, of It's Not Fun Anymore. It's remarkable to think how alike these two bands sound in this song. It's not a million miles away from the original. It's maybe got a bit more hardcore grunt to it in places. And I think that really speaks to the lineage of emo, and how it kind of, like you said, Chris, blossomed from being this late 80s hardcore into something a bit more downbeat, gloomy, cathartic, I suppose, angular in a lot of places. Although Lifetime weren't angular as much, but...
I do think on Hello Bastards there's a track called I'm Not Calling You, which it was really reminiscent of sort of Tin Cans with Strings to You era far.
The reason I think that Jersey's Best Dancers is better than this is because there's a lot more melodic sophistication, particularly guitar parts, on the next album. Even if they only have three speeds as a band, which is mid-tempo, fast beat, and you know, mosh part, that's the only three speeds they have ever had. And I'm glad.
So there's a couple of absolute fucking howlers on this album as well, though. That second track in it, Anchor,
yeah,
I think is horrendous. Again, it just sort of plays into a lot of the stuff that I really fucking hate about this era of pop punk. It didn't have the complete out and out love of pop music the way bands like Green Day or even Offspring or bands that totally fully committed to melody did. But then it didn't have the real kind of edges and the brittle sort of dynamics. I don't mean like the sexiness of Bad Religion, but it doesn't have that edge of bands like that. It's too self-aware maybe to commit completely to melody. I don't know, it just lands at a really uncomfortable sort of compromise for me. But I will concede it absolutely sounds a good 2 or 3 years minimum ahead of a whole wave of bands that arrived on the scene. And in that sense, that's your I'd say a large part of the journey towards me acknowledging it as being unsung for the purposes of the show, because... It's certainly, whether or not I like it, objectively, it certainly sounds like it's arrived in advance and probably played a big part and influence in the bands that followed it.
Yeah.
Well, it must do, because I can understand what you're saying if you feel that songs that they played were lackluster. And when I first listened to the album, I thought, I can't believe that I've never heard this before, but also it sounds like something that I probably would have liked at a certain time when I was young, maybe like 16, and I could hear so many of the bands that I went through a wee phase of listening to at that period in this album. The way that I'm thinking of the album is being actually much better than the kind of stuff that Chris is saying, is because I'm thinking the fact that it predates all these other things that are maybe better than it, it is just clearly so impactful on that generation of musicians playing that type of music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, there's a couple of other tracks on this record which would foreground the stuff that Dan would do with Kid Dynamite, and then subsequently bands that would fall at the back of that. So bands like Dillinger 4, for example, you can hear ostracised. You know, the last track, they clearly took a lot of influence for having that kind of sound. You know, little snippets of great melodies being there, having like different guitars playing different octaves. You know, wee harmonies in the vocals and that kind of thing.
I
And Dillinger Four are really good at that, and they started in 1986, which would have been the year after this album came out. So clearly they were influenced. The next album that came out was in 1987, and that was the one we're talking about, Jazzy's Best Dancers. And that whole year and that whole album and everything that happened around about then is a really sort of important moment in the history of punk and emo music.
So let's come back to that in some detail, and we'll quickly skip ahead though, because after that album, they broke up.
Yeah, they broke up.
Right.
So, yeah. So I mean, I don't know if you know much of the story about what happened with it, but essentially, they were kind of friendly rivals with the Bouncing Souls, who are also really big in the New Brunswick, New Jersey scene. And there was loads of bands that were coming up that were really influenced by them, but were getting places, you know, and they were seeing these bands taking it seriously. And these guys had been in a band now for, I mean, they'd been playing in bands since they were 16, but they'd been lifetime since they were all 18. They'd seen what lay ahead, and they just didn't really want to do that. They didn't want to have to play small shows and try and sell t-shirts to break even every night. Like, this is not why I got into a band. I got into a band just for fun. Well, that was Ari's. That's Ari's view on it anyway. Clearly, Dan felt completely differently due to what he would then go on to do.
Yeah.
But because of that, that's kind of why they stopped being a band. And Dan later said in interviews, like, Lifetime stopped being a band because the people in the band didn't want to be in a band anymore. So I went and did something else.
That may well be the case, that they didn't want to get into that sort of lifestyle, but they went back to it.
Yeah, well, that's the reason they went back to it is because they were asked to do a show at Hellfest 2005. And this is one of the interesting things that we will come to when we talk about the influence of the scene. Hellfest is one of the biggest hardcore and punk festivals in the US, and it takes place in New Jersey. It was really the fulcrum for a lot of this kind of music, where they came from. And they were asked to reunite and play a one-off show, and they said yes, they wanted to do that. Did that, and then they thought, well, let's just put together all of our rarities, all of our old EPs, let's remaster Background, and then like, put the original Background on there, and then do a live version of Background, and put it all in the swamps of New Jersey. It also contains some B-sides from singles as well, which they released, although I think they only released two of them. And then Pete Wentz from the band Fall Out Boy, he's known to be a huge hardcore fan. In fact, all of them are, even though you can't really hear it in their sound particularly anymore. He approached them. He was running a record label at the time called Decay Dance. And he was like, do you guys want to do an album? And they sat about and thought about it. And I was like, well, actually, yeah, we're having fun doing this. So let's just make a record and see what happens. And then they made the album, did a tour, and then stopped being a band again.
The fate of this eponymous album is quite interesting. Cards on the Table, I think it's their best album.
It's a great record, man, as a
total newbie, pound for pound, song for song, it's better than the others, but it seems to have been sort of disowned, or like, I mean, they got shipped out of that label pretty quick afterwards, and it's not on Spotify, which is always quite a conspicuous diss when the most obscure of the obscure people were putting stuff on Spotify to make sure it's part of recorded musical history, and then you get albums like this that by every standard should be on there. You know, it's a red flag. Do you know why that was?
I don't know why that was, to be honest, because the only reason that would be, right, is because the label didn't want, either the band didn't want to put it on, which doesn't make any sense, right, because all of their stuff is on there, so that's clearly not the reason why. They probably just don't own it, I would imagine it.
And the label don't want to put it on there? That seems odd.
I mean, that's the only thing I can think of, because given the history of the band and the fact that, you know, right, I mean, the record came out on a record label, which is pretty big. It would have made a very small impact. It sounds so up-to-date and current, even though they're playing the style they were playing 10 years ago. The production's great on it. Some of the songs are brilliant. The melodies that Ari's singing,
songwriting's better.
Are great.
Yeah.
You know?
It just costs nothing to put something on Spotify. That's what I mean. It's like, it's so easy a process if you're uploading a back catalogue. Probably got interns in there doing it for free just for the privilege of working for Fuel by Ramen or whatever, or an offshoot of it. So I just don't understand why it's not on there. You have to make a decision not to put it on there. But anyway, I mean, like, what do you think of that album? And I think it's pretty good.
I think it's good.
I wouldn't buy it. I wouldn't sit at home and listen to it. But compared to the other stuff, I preferred it.
I like the production on it. I like that Ari's voice is way more sophisticated at this point. He'd gone away and done other things. I think the last record he released was a solo album, which was basically kind of a bit of electro. And he's now a carpenter, incidentally. Got his own carpentry shop, which is cool. But it's got some good songs, man. Northbound Breakdown is a brilliant song. It feels like old Lifetime, but it's just got so much more like melody and better hooks in it. Mm-hmm. Airport Monday Morning was a single. It's got a music video, which is the only music video Lifetime ever had. And that's a pretty great song too. Some awesome harmonies on it. Some really nice guitar interplay as well. Yeah, I think it's got a lot of good songs. Clearly, I haven't spent as much time with it as I'd like because it's not on Spotify. You know, I heard it when it first came out back in 2007 because I was absolutely blown away about the fact it even got back together. So it was great to get a new record from them, and it's just completely baffling as to why it's not there because it is a really good album.
Well, you can get it on YouTube for anyone that's interested in. If you're vaguely curious. I would personally suggest listening to that one first, but you know, do what you want. Can we spend a wee bit of time on 1997, or the year Emo broke, as Vice referred to it?
So 1997, we spoke about this in the Cursive episode. There was two things really happening here. There was a Midwest Emo, which was happening just, you know, a couple of states over, and Cursive were in there, Parade, all that kind of stuff, Cap and Jazz, they were all happening around about this area. And then in the East Coast, you had things like Mineral. And various other bands that were taking the DC Discord Day Fugazi style sound and making it a bit sadder and more cathartic, I suppose.
There's a kind of quite an interesting, it's sort of a listicle made up by Vice under this head in 1997, the year Emo broke, and they break down what they see as a bunch of key albums from that year. It includes a band I'm not massively familiar with, Rainer Maria.
Mm-hmm. Still going,
Yeah, which, I mean, stand out from the pack at this point, especially because it's two out of three members were female. Mm-hmm. And this is definitely a scene that wasn't exactly spoiled.
That's interesting because, I mean, I don't really know much at all about emo music, but all the bands that I've heard that I would class as emo don't have women in them that I know of. No, I've always associated it with, like, guys that want to have a wee greet about the pains of life, you know?
That's basically it. Every time you dumped somebody, Anna, they went away and formed an emo band. So that's the cycle of life in the emo world. It does seem to have been largely a genre for modern men flexing their emotional muscles. There's the Get Up Kids. Because I think it was about 4 Minute Mile came out in 97.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I know them better because of, was it Something to Write Home About?
Yeah,
the 99 album. But
I only know about the Get Up Kids because of that punk CD that came with Kerrang, I think, when I was getting into all of this kind of stuff, and it had Red Letter Day by the Get Up Kids on it. And it didn't really fit with other songs because it was an emo song. It was pretty tame. And I remember at the time trying to listen to more of their stuff, and I just didn't really understand it. I didn't really understand the kind of the soft rock.
I always felt that them, and I think around about the same time Jets to Brazil got picked up by Kerrang, and it was an odd pairing. They did stand out quite a bit on those compilations. Another one we've mentioned before, Mark, Hot Water Music. That year they did two records, didn't they? Feel for the Hate Game and Forever and Counting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We've got Promise Ring. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Promise Ring, they were sort of doing a kind of slightly poppier thing, which was kind of like pushing the boundaries in that direction. You had early, kind of early Doors at the Drive-In. I think El Gran Orgio came out that year. Which I believe was after Acrobatic Tenement, was it?
Yeah.
Before it?
Yeah.
And then that would be before In Casino Out, when they really started to kind of take shape. But they were causing a fuss, you know, they were turning heads, albeit I think they were struggling to kind of keep it together as a band at that point. And there's other ones as well. Ink and Dagger were a band that did quite a lot that year.
Oh, Fucking Dagger, this is so good.
Yeah. A bit edgier. Mm-hmm. You get Samayam. I don't need all I said tonight. I was set for days and my words don't seem to come alright. It's just a phase. You get Early Boy Sets Fire.
Of course, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You get the Ataris. Jimmy Eat World, obviously, we're about. That's the year that Beyond Planet Earth by Shelter came out. Which is a big one. And then you had like slightly more niche things like Egg Hunt and a band that I used to really quite like actually called Small Brown Bike.
They're great, actually. I can't believe you like them.
A couple of belters in that. So, yeah, it was a really busy year for these kind of proto bands. One of the things that I was at least able to surmise from that, listening to the way that the albums were recorded and listening to like some of the changes that were happening in the music, was that there was three standout influences for me that kind of formed these sounds. One that you've mentioned, obviously, is Husker Du.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Husker Du and Bob Mould and Sugar, they had an edginess, they had a weird, awkward take on alternative music. It's like they didn't really know who they were, they were forging a kind of new sound, but there was also a melodic consistency to some of the choices they made. And I think Lifetime actually make a lot of similar choices melodically at some of their better moments, and it betrays that love of Husker Du. And obviously they did the cover as well, so that's pretty obvious. I think a band that's actually really significant in this period of emo music is Quicksand. Not least because Quicksand epitomises the transition of Walter Schreifels from, you know, Gorilla Biscuits, this much more old school conventional thing, like a kind of more archetypal punk thing, into this kind of like post Nirvana alternative. I don't even know what you call it. Like it was like post hardcore at this point. It was really going in an unusual direction, trying to combine something punkier but make it a bit more expansive and make the songs a bit bigger, make the hooks a bit bigger, melodically, even tonally, like the plinky plonky snare drum, you know, that thing that we've talked about. Those kind of like noises really seem to come from Quicksand. I mean, there was bands called Landmine Spring just 2 years after Quicksand released that album, so they clearly had a big impact on the underground scene at that time. And I don't think as well we can look past the huge contribution that was made by Green Day. Green Day, obviously Dookie 94, but then if you look back at like Kerplunk and 1039, the guys that were coming of age, you know, the guys that were 18 in, you know, 1996 when they were starting these bands, they were like 13 and 14 when those records came out, and it was a really, really important age for them to really pick up on new ideas. And Green Day, even though they're a trope now, even though they're a, you know, a dinosaur of a thing now, at the time, there is something really, really vital and exciting about Young Green Day, and then the fact that they married that to commercial success so well in 94 with Dookie, and then after Dookie went on to Insomniac, which was still a very, very good record, like just a very solid, well-written, well-constructed record. They didn't lose the plot early on. I just think that band, we can't ignore, when a lot of the melodic parts pop out of these songs, you can't ignore the role that bands like Green Day played in giving these bands the courage to inject those, because there would be like a wee guy in them, the wee guy in the songwriter that was like, I want to put a bit that you can sing there. And that started to become more of a feature.
Was 1997 the year that Green Day brought out Nimrod?
I think you're right, it'd be 97 or 98, yeah, because Insomniac was, what, 95?
I'm not sure. But see, when you think of their transition as a band to then Nimrod, there's a lot more variety in the songs than there would have been on the other albums. So it must have been like much, they would have been past the point of then being an influence to these different bands that you've mentioned.
Yeah, no, I think it would very much be more the early stuff. And as I said, there's bits on 1039 that really reminded me of some of the earlier stuff put out by Lifetime. Just glimpses, I don't mean full songs, but just little glimpses. And lastly, like Mark, you touched on the, no, sorry, Anna, you touched on the Kerrang CD. I think we have to acknowledge the huge, huge influence of the Emo Diaries at this period.
Yeah, totally. Mm-hmm.
The Deep Elm compilation series. In terms of grouping things together for folk, you're talking about Drive Through as well, Anna.
Mm-hmm.
Like, those were such a big feature. And the power of compilations, the power of getting on a compilation, the power of being the first track in a compilation, or, you know, a standout track in a compilation, mm-hmm. you know. That was a really, really big part of, I'd imagine, our introduction to a lot of bands
when we were
young, but also these bands breaking. If you got on a compilation, it was a huge achievement.
Yeah, and I Drive Through Records, probably a bit early to talk about them, but see, just since you mentioned, I remember them having a compilation CD. It was a Drive Through Records sampler that came with a UK magazine that was kind of skate punk themed. Mark, do you know what that would have been?
The Big Cheese.
Big Cheese, that's it. And I remember it was an actual sampler. So getting stuff like that free with a magazine, obviously the Kerrang one was free, but to be promoting a whole record label through a free CD with a magazine of that type at that time, you know, that would have made a huge impact on their fan base.
Yeah, and I think that's a good shout. Those two albums that you didn't really mention, Chris, which were definitely influential on 1997 as well, one of them being 24 Hour Revenge Therapy by Jawbreaker. Which I think is just as important to a lot of people as Green Day would have been at that time. They were the kind of awkward sort of twin cousin, I suppose, produced by Steve Albini. It's a fucking cracking album. I suppose you could maybe make a case for it to be in this podcast at some point, although it's hugely influential and they're a really well-known band now, in certain quarters anyway. And then Weezer. and all Weezer.
Oh yeah, yeah. Of course, yeah. Of course.
Huge influence.
Excuse me, Mark. Can we just pronounce it properly for Dave?
Weezer.
What?
Dave does that every time. It's
but where's the
lovely.
H? Where's
exactly.
The H?
Where is the H?
In his head.
Yeah, I always remember Weezer being classed as like a mainstream kind of emo pop rock band, but they were only a band that I knew through seeing their videos on the telly. Didn't really know many folk that were that into them.
Yeah. Or on Windows 94.
Yeah.
95.
Sorry, Windows 95. 95. Yeah. You bloody Holly video just kicking about on an old computer somewhere. But all of that music and all the 1997 stuff that happened, obviously we put this album in with that as well. But it had a huge influence on some massive bands that would then form out the back of these kinds of scenes. I'm thinking about people like Brand New, My Chemical Romance, Taking Back Sunday. These bands are all on record as saying Lifetime was the reason that they were bands. This album in particular was the key thing which actually made them go, fuck man, we can be a band, we can do that. And
surprised.
These bands became massive.
I'm surprised that you didn't mention Newfound Glory there. Because as soon as I listened to this album, I thought, oh, that is just like that first Newfound Glory album, because it's got the heavy bits as well as the pure melodic poppy parts, and just, I guess, the fact that they're both like emo pop punk sounds as well. That was the band that I thought of straight away. And then when I went and I was listening to it on YouTube, and I went through the comments, and loads of folk were talking about Saves the Day, and I hadn't
Saves the Day, yeah.
Yeah, I hadn't clocked that until I saw the comments, and I thought, oh yeah, massively. So I quite liked a wee bit of Saves the Day. I liked their lyrics were normally quite interesting. I've been to see them before as well, despite not being a fan of emo music. I do love pop punk, and yes, you can definitely hear it in their music as well.
Yeah, I think Saves the Day are a really interesting one, because they actually played quite a lot with A Newfound Glory when they were called A Newfound Glory at the time. Around around this scene, you know, in 1997, 1998, 1999, that kind of era, you know. So yeah, they were all coming up at the same time, all influenced by bands, by Lifetime in particular, and bands like it. And of course, I've already spoken about Fall Out Boy. You're just fucking ginormous. Yeah, the influence of this band and a lot of these, particularly the East Coast stuff, you know, like Taking Back Sunday and all that, and Saves the Day. Yeah. They do reckon that this is probably the most influential album, but obviously listen to all the other ones we mentioned as well, you know, Braid, Captain Jazz, all that kind of shit. I would definitely listen to that too. To kind of bring us back to the start, and I won't talk about this for too long, but one of the things I mentioned back at the start is I always see them as a melodic hardcore band, and that's the side of the sound I always hear. I never really heard the emo, even though I like emo, I never really heard that. So for me, whenever I hear Lifetime, the bands that immediately jump to mind that are influenced by them are bands like, you know, smaller bands like Latterman, who sound so much like Lifetime but are just way more kind of punky, just straight up punky. Turn Up the Punk, We'll Be Singing is a phenomenal album, and I think it will definitely be on this pod at some point. You've got The Movie Life, who were from the same area, popped out in the 2000s, so they were on Drive Thru, like you mentioned, Anna. But my favourite band, I suppose, from this whole time but who've been influenced by them, is a wee band called Shook Ones. They've got an album called The Unquotable AMH, which is just the perfect distillation of what would happen if you really pushed the melodic side of Lifetime and played more with melodies and made it just like all breakneck speed. You know, it's dead cathartic, brilliant, brilliant stuff. And then to me, there's the other side, which is Dan Yemen and Kid Dynamite. So the reason I couldn't decide between this and the first Kid Dynamite album was because Dan Yemen was in both bands, and I really don't think I'd get away with having more than one album with him on it in this podcast. So
yeah,
I went with Lifetime, but Kid Dynamite was so, so close. They had a huge, huge influence on the sound that I grew up, the punk sound that I grew up loving. You know, I was a huge fan of Rise Against in the first couple of albums in the early 2000s. After I got into them, I started to find out more about Rise Against, and that they were formed from a band called 88 Fingers Louie, who did a split EP with Kid Dynamite, and that's how I got into them. All of this kind of plays together in my head, so for me it's really difficult to kind of remove the hardcore side of it, because for me I see Lifetime and I see like bands like Crime and Stereo, I see Rise Against, you know, I see Strike Anywhere and A Will Em Scream, mm-hmm. and a whole different side of hardcore music which I didn't know existed.
Mm-hmm. You're so right, Mark, because see all of those bands that you just mentioned, my husband Lewis loves all of them and Hot Water Music and stuff that I know that you're really into as well. And after I listened to the first song off of this Lifetime album, I went straight through to the other room and said to him, you need to listen to this. Did you listen to it when you were younger? Because this sounds exactly like the type of thing that you would love. Mm-hmm. And stuck it on for him. And he was really enjoying it as well. So you've really hit the nail on the head there.
And then, I guess, just to kind of tie this point up, melodic hardcore then has now become something completely different. It sounds a lot more like emo now. It's kind of, Craig calls it shouting into an empty room hardcore, or as I like to call it, she's turned the wains against us hardcore, because it just just sounds like a guy in the street just fucking screaming that she's turned the wains against us to a room full of people over what would ostensibly be late 80s, early 90s emo.
Hang on, Mark. We're just going to throw this in there. I'll do my Edinburgh BBC voice again. She's turned the wains against us means my ex-partner has been saying nasty things about me to the children, and now the children don't like me.
Yeah, if you haven't seen it, you should YouTube the Lemmy sketch, She's Turned the Wind Against Us, and you'll see exactly what I mean. And if you know, but I love bands like Defeated and Touche Amore, but, you know, bands that kind of do that kind of music, I love that kind of shit, but there's absolutely no denying that when you see him walking down the street, fucking bare-chested in his jacket, shouting She's Turned the Ways Against Us, it sounds exactly like the singers in these bands.
I would love to hear a clip of you overlaying that vocal from Lemmy onto one of these pure whinging hardcore band songs, and let's see how it goes. It could be a hit.
You'd love to hear that, eh?
I would.
Right, okay. Duly noted.
Chris, if you're looking for a reference, I would look at La Dispute, and you'll be able to find something that will perfectly fit that.
So you want to take us on a wee guided tour of this record, Mark?
Yeah, let's do it. We've done all the history
The episode's already 3 times longer than the albums.
It's actually longer than the entire discography at this point as well.
23 minutes long, 12 tracks, that's pretty good going there.
Well, you know what, I like brevity when it comes to punk music, and this band deliver that in spades, and I think that's one of their strengths as a band. I think, given they've only got 3 speeds and they're kind of basically doing variations on the same idea throughout 12 songs, I think sticking around for any longer than half an hour is going to be tiring anyway. And you actually see a bit of that in backgrounds. A lot of the songs in background are actually 3.5 minutes long, and it starts to feel a bit tiring at that. And that was before they were actually really good at writing this kind of music. So I love the brevity of this record, you know. Opens with Turnpike Gates. We will take ourselves so bad. starts with a spoken word intro, which has become a thing that lots of bands would do. Bands still do that, even though it's totally old hat at this point.
Before Huey gets on the phone, I'd just like to point out that Fun Loving Criminals had cornered the market in adding film samples into music.
Yeah, but hardcore bands were doing it for so long as well, man, like from the 80s, you know.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, Ministry were doing a fair bit of it as well. But yeah, I mean, I don't think it ever got any better though than Fun Loving Criminals, really.
I don't think it was ever good, to be fair, ever. But there you go. It's got the classic chunky hardcore guitars and big beefy drums, but Ari's cleaned up his vocals as much as possible. I think they're a bit of an acquired taste in this record. He slurs a lot when he sings. He sounds a bit like Tim Armstrong in places. But to me, it's the most melodic thing they've done this far. You can hear them really refining the sound. It's got the big drum roll around 1 minute 30. They kind of change the structure a little bit. It's got some really nice guitar hooks.
So this is one of the tracks to me that draws the most comparisons with, like I said, 1039 era Green Day. Mm-hmm. I think it has a lot of that kind of youthful melodic energy.
Yeah, but there's also remaining with the hardcore bits, you know, still with the same kind of fast beat drumming and the thick slabs of riffs. And I think for me this song's a really good yardstick for the album, and given the kind of whole emo nature of the lyrics, they do quite a lot over the course of this record to actually switch up like where the melody is focused. Listen to this album after, you know, writing music which used to be quite similar to this. It was remarkable to me how they were able to cram in like guitars doing two different melodic things at the same time without ever losing the chunk, you know, and it takes a few listens to unpack that, but it's definitely there, you know, and it's a little thing that I hadn't ever noticed before.
Yeah, I was really impressed with that first song. As I mentioned, as soon as I heard it, I thought, oh wow, this is actually totally different from what I was expecting it to be, and was really impressed by it. And for me, I could also hear the kind of sounds that I would have heard off of different Hellcat record bands who were around a few years after that. They don't, like, vocally, they don't sound anything like Leftover Crack, but there was elements of the style of bass playing within it that I could hear them in, and I was really pleasantly surprised when it started.
Yeah, and then they're going to Loud, Young and Scotty, which I think is also a really good song.
Young, Loud and Scotty.
Young, Loud and Scotty. It's got a lovely little, it kind of leads on directly from the last song, which I can forgive it because the last song was over 2 minutes 20 long and this one's less than 2 minutes. So it's got some great drumming actually. I think that's actually the highlight of the song. And there's loads of, again, there's loads of layers of melody kicking around in the guitars, octave guitars in the fast bit, the vocal melody and the breakdown is really cool. Mm-hmm. There's a lead guitar down the right channel, just playing a nice little ditty almost. You can totally see where bands like Newfound Glory got their sound from, right? It comes from doing this with hardcore. It's like turning hardcore into almost pop punk, and this is kind of what they do on this song.
I think this song suffers from that phenomenon that's appeared numerous times in the podcast, where I find it hard to be objective about it because what it does has been so totally rinsed by bands in subsequent years that when I hear this, I just hear endless support bands at gigs that I've been to on like fucking Tuesday night, and it's just like it's been so done to death that I find it very hard to judge it on its own merits. So I couldn't really form an opinion on this song, I'll be honest. I was just like listening to it and it was just like staring at a beige wall. I couldn't, and it's a template that people didn't just adhere to, they aped it. The one after it,
Francis Nolan.
Yeah, I mean, I liked the kind of instrumentally sort of creative way that they went into the song, but I think it just sort of then surrenders back into what's maybe expected of it a bit. And I also wish they'd changed the vocal key for this tune, because the vocal comes in at exactly the same pitch as the previous tune, and it just already, only three songs in for me, it's a little bit samey. I think you need to, there's certain things when you're sequencing, when your music is quite of a specific style, you need to try and find like key changes, for example, are an important way to differentiate track from track. You know, you don't put four songs in a row with the vocals in the exact same key. This was just a poor bit of sequencing in their part.
I think it's a criticism you could level a lot of hardcore music. I think that's still the hardcore songwriters in them. Because you could think about Black Flag as well, and Minor Threat, stuff like that. You know, still doing like really similar things vocally, like from song to song.
Yeah.
I love
Minor Threat, but so many of their songs sound so, so similar.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't really see that as a criticism for a band who do that sound really well. And although songs can be samey on this album, I felt like it flowed really nicely.
Yeah, I mean, one thing I was going to say is, like, I actually think this, the flow of the record is basically just to be as fast and as straight up as possible. Again, being hardcore kids, I think Fancy Knows a pretty good song, you know. Again, like I said, I've said it multiple times, I'll say it again, this album, this band, it only has three speeds, mid-tempo rock, two-step mosh parts, and then fast beats. That's all it does, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this entire album is a variation and a theme, like I've said. But I like how they switch up the formula in different songs, you know. They've got Pam Mutant part in different place here. It gives it a kind of more mid-tempo feel. They switch between the mosh parts and the Pam Mutant parts to give a little bit more of a dynamic musically.
Yeah, but your average punter's not really going to make such fine distinctions, and I think that's the reason that some artists break through and others don't break through to wider audiences. A band like this will be beloved by a certain audience and will fail to make a breakthrough, and I think it'll be decisions like that, relying on very, very fine distinctions. I think this album would have been better if they'd swapped the third and the fourth track around, put it that way, right? So 25 Cent Giraffes comes in. Which is much more of a Husker Du
yeah, totally.
Vibe. It's got Bob Mould melodies in it. It's got a much more emo feel to it. And I think you could still have the two tracks in it, but reverse that order, and the second and third track then don't clash. And then the fifth track is so different that it then doesn't clash with the fourth track. And I think it's little decisions like that that determine whether a band ever gets a breakthrough album, because your average punter is not as so willing to invest all the effort to appreciate the nuance. They just want distinction and identity, you know. And I'm one of them in this case. I'm not massively invested in this, and it didn't hold my attention. But I think it's partly because of decisions like that.
I think that's a really interesting point that you're making. If we then consider what Mark was saying earlier about how the band did not want to then be a professional band, you know, they didn't want to be away on tour all the time, and they didn't want this as their careers. And those little slight adjustments and decisions are made by the types of bands who are clearly going all in with their dedication to seeing their music as a career, and that is what sets them apart, isn't it?
Mm. Yeah, but I mean, I imagine a lot of those bands didn't know they were going to have a breakthrough. They just put together an album and arranged the songs in a way that felt good to them, and it turned out it was just a little bit better considered.
Do you not think, though, they would have been working towards that, a lot of these bands?
I think if there was a formula to engineer breakthrough, then everybody would do it. I think sometimes you just make it, you can only identify some of these decisions in retrospect. When they don't happen, you can maybe point to things that might have been part of the reason it didn't happen. I mean, it's a very tenuous suggestion for me to say that that's why they didn't make a breakthrough, because they got a couple of songs in the wrong order.
But I think it adds up
to whether or not you want to hear an album all the way through, or whether or not you switch it off. I don't know, but I think like the fourth song's good. The fifth song was Hey Katrina,
yeah.
Yeah. again, useful change of pace at this point.
Yeah.
It's got a kind of drunken sing-along thing
totally.
Going on.
Great hook, man. Great hook in it as well.
Kind of chunky thing and... 24 years old, this song, I guess. So, I mean, I don't want to be too critical of it because I would say it's a little bit bland, but, you know, it was a progenitor of that sound, and so the craft was yet to be honed.
I like that song a lot, and I think that, for me, it captures the youthful energy of the band, and it feels kind of right that they would stop being a band after this, to be honest. I do think that maybe their next album could have been great, and their next album is good, but I mean, it's fucking 10 years later, right? So you've changed a lot as a person, as a songwriter in that space of time. But it got critical acclaim at the time, but I listen to this record and I just think to myself, these guys were writing it to play in a fucking basement show in New Jersey. They were falling into the same trap that every hardcore band falls into, right? They just want to play fucking slamming songs back to back. So having the balls to come in and go, here's something a little bit different, Hey Katrina is a really good example of that. It's actually annoying that Hey Katrina isn't right in the centre of the record, because bringing it backwards is bringing it right back to the start of their entire career. It's a straight up hardcore punk song, more or less. It's really tight, it's really focused. It's over before it begins, to be honest. It's got a melodic intro at the end, which kind of stands out a bit like a sore thumb.
Anna, I've got two words for you here.
Oh no.
Pennywise, your bass. This has like a lot of like early Pennywise in it, this one.
Oh, yeah. God.
How do you feel about that, Anna?
I'm not, you know what, like... Part of me is like, don't even take the bait. And then I think, no, that could be really entertaining for listeners to get in a bit of a dialogue about it. But actually, ultimately, I don't think I know enough about not only early Pennywise, but this type of music to then get into a debate about it.
I do think it's sort of a relevant comparison at this point, but I was just going to make sure that I shoehorned it in at some stage.
I was waiting for that Bad Religion, so...
He's already said
already
Bad Religion.
Yeah, I did that.
There's no avoiding it. I mean, like, there's not about 100 other bands that were on Epitaph or whatever else that you could... draw comparison to, because see, all the bands that I can think of drawing comparison to, they all come after this band, so it's difficult for me to pass comment on it, any similarities to their peers, you know. And
but who are some of those bands though?
Well, we mentioned Newfound Glory, and I was actually also going to say The Movie Life. Actually, think like the poppy side of them sounds a wee bit like MXPX as well.
Oh God, yeah.
And you know, there's a band that nobody wants to remember. Actually, they played in Glasgow a few years ago. This is a brilliant story for you, Chris. This ties in perfectly. they played in Glasgow. They came down to Block afterwards, and I was DJing in there. But it was a one-off thing that me and Brian were doing. Brian McGarvey, the two of us were DJing punk music, and I think it was Bob was throwing an after party for the gig. He'd probably put it on. So I'd dug out all these old pop punk CDs that I hadn't played in years, and I remember the singer of MXPX coming up to me and asking me if I would play some Bad Religion. And I got the chance to say to him, no, because they're pish.
Zing.
Fucking hell.
I was so excited about it at the time as well. Yes! Yes, yes, yes. Can't believe I didn't tell you. This is maybe before you were doing the Unsung podcast and I heard you mention Bad Religion every month. Or every couple of weeks, or every week for that matter.
Right.
Speaking of Bad Religion, right. I think How We Are has a lot.
Hang on. Speaking about shite punk songs, How We Are, number seven.
It's got a lot of Bad Religion. It's actually sang by the bassist at the start as well, which is kind of weird.
Fucking rubbish, this song. Hated it.
I think it's too short to be rubbish.
Hated it.
That's fucking rubbish, man.
I there weren't any songs when I listened to this that I thought, oh no, that's terrible. That's so rubbish. That's an insult. I just thought, oh, this is a nice wee album.
That's the problem with you guys and your punk music. You need standards.
Well, clearly I do, that I think Bad Religion are pish.
No, you're just a contrarian, mate. You just got a bee in your bonnet, got a chip in your shoulder. A bee with a chip. Right, track 8. Theme song from a New Brunswick basement show.
Yeah, this is often talked about. It's been one of the most influential songs on the record. A lot of bands and a lot of people in bands single this song. It's been a game changer. It's a little bit. It is definitely way more emo, man. Emo, actually. I think it sounds a bit like Jawbox in places.
Yeah, this is definitely the most authentically new emo sounding, and I think it sounds more credible. It sounds more underground. It's got a lot more of the kind of Deep Elm edginess to it.
Yeah, it's got some cool dynamics, and it's not really punky or hardcore, which is obviously why it's emo. And they do different things melodically here, which they haven't really done anywhere else in their career. So I think the next album could have been more of this if they kept in at it, to be honest. But obviously they didn't. And they cut the tension and go straight back to melodic hardcore. I would call it melodic hardcore. Very bouncy song. I love the outro, man. It's just ridiculous. That's sort of staccato rhythm. The way they bring it up at the end, I think that's pretty cool. The truth about Lars always makes me laugh. It's got a proper 80s hardcore vibe at the start, and then it goes into the typical Lifetime fast beat thing that they always do.
I'm pretty drained at this point, honestly.
But I like the lyrics to it, man. It's a goofy song. The lyrics are kind of sweet, and then it's got that weird oo-oos, which is clearly them just goofing about in the studio. It goes to kind of reinforce the idea that they were just not taking this seriously at all.
Mm-hmm.
The Boy's No Good is the best song on the album. Absolute fact. One of my top 10 favourite punk songs of all time.
That's a bold statement.
Yeah.
Funnily enough, yeah, I've written next to it, best song.
Yep.
Question mark.
The catchiest thing on the album. It's been covered by so many fucking bands since. The speed of it, the octave guitars, the chanting vocal before the breakdown, and the breakdown's massive as well. Whole thing is just a triumph, man, and it's over in 1 minute and 12 seconds.
Yeah, the breakdown's 38 seconds into the song.
Yeah,
that's my kind of song. I like it when they're short and sharp like that and straight to the point.
Yeah, the whole second half of the song is this big gang chant hook as well. Mm-hmm. It's a decent bit of music. Yeah, Yeah. I don't. Well, I have absolutely no idea why they tried to follow that on this record,
yeah,
let alone why they tried to follow it with the Verona Kings, which is just a weaker song by every single measure.
Yeah, I think the vocal melody is quite cool on it, actually, and there is some nice bass playing on it as well, but you're like, why didn't you just not extend The Boy's Not Good by another 2 minutes, and then you'd be you'd be golden.
Because then Anna would take the hump.
Then I would be as angry as Chris.
Yeah, or they could have compromised and just swapped them around. It's just, yeah. It's a bit, The Boy's Not Good would have been a very, very strong ending.
It would have, yeah, I agree, I think.
And again, that's a sequencing mistake in my book. It's a bit of naivety there, and I think this album has a few sequencing mistakes in it.
But that is the album. That is Jersey's Best Dancers by Lifetime.
It is.
Obviously, I'm thinking it's going to go in a discography, because we've got voting back on Facebook, peeps, so this will be our first Facebook vote, I suppose.
Democracy is back.
Proper democracy. Zuckerberg sponsored democracy.
Well, Anna, you're going to put it in, aren't you?
Yeah, I definitely would. I mean, I'm going to confess, I didn't listen to their other albums, but based on what Mark has described that they sound like, and the fact that I listened to this, really enjoyed it. You know, first time hearing it as a 35-year-old when I was only into that very niche type of pop-punk music when... For a brief period when I was about 16, and I listened to it for the first time and really enjoyed it, and I thought, this is quite weird because I haven't listened to an album of that type of music in so long, and immediately thought, oh, this is doing something for me. I really felt like it was nice and upbeat, and when you consider the context of it, the fact that it came out in 1997, it was so far ahead of all these other bands that I could definitely hear within the music. I just thought, yeah, they've done a really nice job of it. 22 minutes long, is it?
23.
So that in itself was great, because the first time that I listened to it, I decided to just go out for a wee quick walk, and while I was out for a walk, the album finished, and I was really surprised because I hadn't looked at the length of time it was, and I, as I say, I like it when stuff is straight to the point. I felt that they achieved it, so yeah, I would definitely put it in.
I'm gonna have to like try and be the bigger man here, right? Because see, you make a good point. This band is clearly, along with a few others, had a large influence on a huge amount of music that sounded very, very similar to this that followed, the vast majority of which I think is fucking terrible music. I hate it. I find it really tedious, really trying. It doesn't speak to any of the things that I look for in punk, and it doesn't take any chances. Like, but we're talking about the bands that came after this. I think those bands really exploit the template set by this. So, despite the fact that they have inflicted on me countless fucking garbage support bands, countless half hours kicking about in venues waiting for some shit to finish, like, despite all those miserable experiences that this album has probably contributed to, I am going to rise above and I am going to say, yes, it's very influential. I think the album that came after it is better, song for song, but the album that came after it doesn't have any of the kind of huge significance that this one has, this or the one before it has. I mean, I think Hello Bastards, you could really make a case for that being very, very important as well. But one way or the other, it's a band that probably needs represented. There's certainly no danger that they're ever getting on this programme again, because I don't want to listen to them anymore. But yeah, put it in, get it the fuck out of my sight.
Yeah, okay. Well done, Mark.
We'll see what the public say. You actually touched upon something that I was going to bring up at the time, but I suppose now's a good time to bring up as well, Chris. It's responsible for a lot of shit bands. So are Bad Religion, and we said the same thing on the Bad Religion episode as well. Was like, it's really easy to do it. It's really, really hard to get it right, you know. And so many bands just do it because it's dead easy to fucking sling four cross together and wail some shite over it. But
the thing is, the bands that try to sound like Bad Religion don't sound like Bad Religion. Bad Religion are fucking brilliant and their tunes are amazing, whereas the bands that try to sound like this sound exactly like this. There's no challenge. It's not got the songwriting nous or the harmonies or the dynamism of Bad Religion. It doesn't have any of that for me.
Yeah, there's a whole lot of bands on Bad Religion. I'll maybe make a playlist for you can listen to that.
Do you know how many times I've had people tell me that bands sound like Bad Religion, and then you're like, you clearly don't get Bad Religion if you think that sounds like them. But okay, go for it. Why not? Fucking, let's go through this one more time.
Please let's not go through this one more time, because we sat down for 3 hours recording the other 2 episodes on Bad Religion. So I think it's about time that Bad Religion go to bed.
You could just drop this pretense that you don't like them once and for all, okay? Anyway, you know something else that we're going to go through one more time? It's a fucking Nexus.
This is the first time we're seeing Nexus tonight. Will it be the last? What do they have in store for us?
Not good.
Why am I here?
You're in the Nexus.
This is the Nexus.
For you, this is what you want.
Yes, what is the Nexus, Chris?
Ah, right. The Nexus is Leonard Pierce, which was chosen by Mr. Declan McCafferty, who used to be our most Irish-sounding backer, but has since been replaced by Taiga Ochama.
Yeah.
Yeah, Leonard Pierce, which is actually spelled LeonardPierce. So me googling Leonard Pierce did not help. But this is your choice, Mark, so you get to go first.
Okay, so Lifetime, we're a band.
Don't do the Kevin Bridges thing.
What's the Kevin Bridges thing?
Right, do the Kevin Bridges thing.
Lifetime are a band from New Brunswick, New Jersey. I just don't have the energy for it, man.
Sack it.
You need to do a thicker Glasgow accent. I know. For that.
Lifetime are a band from New Brunswick, New Jersey. I actually peaked when I did that.
You mean in your career?
I think it actually might be, you know. Also from that same town is Mad Shagger and great actor Michael Douglas. he's a great actor, he's won many awards. He was in a Steven Soderbergh film called Traffic. Have you seen it?
I've not seen it.
A really good film.
The scenes are all shot with a different colour filter to distinguish some of the stuff. It's good.
Ooh, yeah. That sounds very arty.
In that film is a gentleman called Albert Finney, whose character was named, and I quote, White House Chief of Staff. He didn't even give him a name. His character was literally named White House Chief of Staff, which I thought was quite funny. He starred in a film called The Gathering Storm with Mr. Jim Broadbent. Albert Finney played Winston Churchill, and Jim Broadbent played Desmond Morton, who was pivotal in organising the response to the appeasement prior to World War II. He was also Winston Churchill's PA. Did you know that Jim Broadbent was initially eyed for the role of Del Boy Trotter in Only Fools and Horses?
Well. Yeah.
He eventually obviously lost out to David Jason, but he did show up in the show as a police officer called DCI Roy Slater, and Leonard Pierce played the granddad in Only Fools and Horses.
Bravo.
Anna?
I'm pretty jelly. Mine's only going to last about 2 minutes. That's an exaggeration. So, in classic style for me, I've went the wrong way around when I've typed my notes.
You've done a mark.
So I need to start from the end. I hope this works this way. Paint It Black is a hardcore band based out of Philadelphia, which Dan Yemen of the band Lifetime is in. Mm-hmm. Paint It Black was an iconic song written and performed by the Rolling Stones, which has influenced many musicians for decades since. Brian Jones of the Rolling Stones was a multi-instrumentalist who performed sitar on the song Paint It Black. Brian Jones controversially wore a Nazi uniform on a photo shoot while touring Germany.
As you do.
Yeah. And as we all know, various rock stars throughout history have worn Nazi paraphernalia to arouse controversy, including iron crosses and armbands.
Yeah, not in Germany, though. not in Germany 20 years after the war. Yeah.
Okay, so Leonard Pierce once performed in front of senior members of the Nazi Party during the 1930s while on a performance tour of Germany, even shaking the hand of Adolf Hitler.
That's mad, eh?
That's mad.
Apparently he told Nicholas Lyndhurst Rodney on the set of Only Fools and Horses that his biggest regret was not being able to just, like, pull a gun out of the holster of one of the guards and execute Hitler on the spot.
Yeah, imagine how different history would be had the
Grandpa Trotter.
I mean, it's pretty great when you consider, you know, in the TV series Only Fools and Horses, his tagline was always "June War," and there you go. In the 1930s, he had the very chance to combat the Nazi Party and passed it up.
What he's done, though, is the biggest ever example of the, you know, getting halfway down the road and then thinking about the smart reply you should have given to the guy in the chippy.
Yeah.
You know, it's like you just shook the hand of Hitler and then you get halfway down the road, you're like, oh, I should have pulled out that gun and shot him.
And then you
run the scenario in your head and feel better about yourself.
Aye, but you are a wee bit like, aye, Leonard, did you think about that? Maybe it's cool to say that now that everybody hates the Nazis, but back then you were too busy shaking hands with them.
Well, in the mid-30s, everyone loved the Nazis, didn't they? Before World War II, they all fucking loved the Nazis.
Aye, before they realised that they were murdering bastards.
My turn.
Yeah.
Just, I mean, I don't know if I even have Nazis in here.
What?
Lifetime have a track called Francis Nolan.
Francis
Nolan. Francis
Nolan. give her a full name.
I'm sure the track's about the same person. Professor Francis Nolan is a professor of phonetics at Cambridge University. He's also the president of the British Association of Phoneticians. Now, Professor Francis Nolan, is credited for creating parcel tongue. And the mark I asked you about this earlier on, thinking nobody would really know, but it turns out you're a giant geek.
Have you met me?
You do look like an emo Harry Potter anyway, don't you? But parcel tongue is the language of like snakes and stuff in Harry Potter, right? It's in the Goblet of Fire quite substantially, I think. And the people that can talk to the serpents and all that kind of stuff are known as parcel mouths. And they all descend from Salazar Slytherin. That'll mean something to someone that's read Harry Potter or watched it. It's not me. In Harry Potter, Hagrid, which is played by Robbie Coltrane, I think at the request of J.K. Rowling, was actually originally meant to be played by Robin Williams.
Oh, really?
J.K. Rowling overruled it. She blocked it. And Robin Williams has another role that he very nearly played. That's the role of Jack Torrance in The Shining.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Stanley Kubrick decided that for some reason the guy who was playing Mark on Mork and Mindy at the time had like hidden depths and he wanted to try and get him in to do Jack Torrance. Obviously, it didn't go to Robin Williams in the end. Stanley Kubrick created the film 2001 AD Space Odyssey. In Montenegro, an art space, I think it's actually a museum called the Palazzo Malapiero, in San Marco, they held an exhibition called Odisseia, or I don't know exactly how they pronounce it, but I'm going to say Odisseia, which was kind of starting from the point of 2001, A Space Odyssey, and it was a sort of reflection on human evolution, extraterrestrial life, technology, the future, AI, dystopia, all kinds of things like that. Anyway, every day in Montenegro, they show Only Fools and Horses. They are obsessed with the show in Montenegro. We don't know why, but Nicholas Lyndhurst has spoken repeatedly about how whenever he goes to Montenegro, he is like mobbed. whenever you go to Montenegro, it's not something you just accidentally do. Yeah. I get the feeling Nicholas Lyndhurst goes to Montenegro to be mobbed. Right? But Nicholas Lyndhurst seems to spend an inordinate amount of time in Montenegro where being he's mobbed. Frequently mobbed by people who are in love with his show. And Edward Trotter, aka Grandpa, was played by Leonard Pierce in the show Only Fools and Horses. No Nazis in that nexus.
Well done, bravo. Uh-huh, I'm impressed.
All right. First and foremost, Anna, thank you very much for doing
that. Thank you.
Thanks for having me. Thanks for enlightening me by introducing me to this album.
I feel you bring an air of composure and professionalism to the show that's lacking when it's just the three of us.
I agree.
We've developed an unhealthy dynamic of just getting a little bit too excited and carried away, whereas you sort of, you're demure.
I'm quite a composed person, you know. Before we record, Chris, you're always saying to me, you know, be ruthless. If you hate something, just tell it like it is. Whereas I'd like to think of myself as more of a critical thinker rather than someone who's just going to be like, aye, that's pish. But obviously I've contradicted myself by referencing speaking to the singer MXPX earlier on. So yeah, I must only be composed when I'm actually recording things.
It's important to remember though that a lot of stuff is pish.
Most stuff is pish. Most things that exist are pish.
And with this podcast, we are not looking to make any friends or get invited to any parties.
Clearly.
That ship sailed pretty early on, I think.
I think we're definitely off Biffy Clyro's Christmas card list anyway. So,
man, if there's a Scottish band that still speaks to us, it must be just because they haven't heard it. So David's not here, but next week is David's choice. And he has sent that in advance. Mark, are you familiar with it?
You complete bastard, no.
Right, hang on. ESG.
ESG, there you go.
There's a band called EGS and they have an album called ESG.
I think that might be the album that he's talking
about. This is what happens when the guy's not here, yeah. So this is an all-female post-punk band for the Bronx.
Wow. There you go. That'll be an education as well.
Wait a second. Are we talking about the same person? It's the band's called ESG and the album's called Come Away with ESG. Is it the same band?
Tune in next week when David's back.
Who knows?
Is to rights. And the Nexus next week we'll be linking ESG to Gigi Allen. Thanks to Turnstile Blues on Twitter.
Oh, brilliant.
That's going to be great.
Who doesn't love a bit of Gigi Allen, eh?
I mean, it's like, it's going to be some short Nexus. All right, guys, I'm out of here. I'm away to feel poorly. Anna, pleasure as always.
Thanks for having me, lads. Great to see you both virtually.
All right, catch you later.
Bye.
Take care. Bye.